while you're alive, you have the opportunity to do good works, yes, and to please God. But then you have to ask yourself a question: what pleases God and what displeases God? So for that, you have to refer back to the revelation of God.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فتعالى الله الملك الحق ولا تعجل بالقرآن من قبل أن يقضى إليك وحيه وقل رب زدني علما.
I mean, my name is Hashim.
Yes, you're called.
Yes. So yeah, I mean, any topic you want to discuss that between Islam, Christianity, whatever you feel comfortable.
Okay. I want to share something.
Yeah.
Which I've recently been researching because I've had Mormon missionaries come to visit me at my home. I've had discussions with them. One is from Utah. One is from Tahiti. And. I reread the Book of Mormon for a second time. I had read it previously, and the main issue I have with them is in 3 Nephi, where they say that Jesus came from heaven, and then all the Nephites felt the wounds in his side. And I said, how can a spirit body come from heaven and then transform into a physical body? It doesn't make sense to me.
So just for the audience, who are the Nephites?
The Nephites are one of the tribes of Israel who traveled on a boat. They would have traveled down Saudi Arabia and left on a boat from what is now Yemen, and using the jet stream would have traveled eastwards, and the best guess is they arrived in what is now Guatemala.
And they're the descendants of?
They are descendants of one of the tribes of Israel.
Okay.
The elder brother, according to Mormon scripture, is Nephi, and the younger brother is Laman. There were 2 other brothers, but Laman was not happy with the rule of Nephi, because he was a younger brother, and he persuaded the other 2 brothers to try and make enmity with Nephi and his followers. That is the story in the Book of Mormon. I've got no reason to doubt that story, that the essential history of the Nephites and the Lamanites as depicted in the Book of Mormon. But I do question some of the references to Jesus and to God in this Book of Mormon, the way the Mormons believe about what the Mormons believe about Jesus and God.
Do they believe Jesus is God? Just like, you're not a Mormon, you're a
Christian. I'm not a Mormon, no.
You're a Protestant Christian.
Well, I'm from that background.
What is their belief? How is it different to yours?
Right, well,
with regards to Jesus.
I asked them the question. You believe he came from heaven in a supernatural resurrected body and appeared to the Nephites in AD 34.
According
to the subtext
side
of the Book of Mormon. And I said to them, do you have any tradition of him coming over on a boat? And they said, no. So I Googled it. And what came up was this book, which I ordered from Abe Books, He Walked the Americas by L. Taylor Hansen, 1963. In this book, there are at least four references to him arriving at various parts of America on a boat. Jesus. Yes.
Yeah, but,
yes.
Come on.
Now, Joseph of Arimathea was a metal merchant, his uncle and guardian. He had control of a fleet of Roman ships. The first chapter in this book refers to what the Tahitians referred to as Tahira, the prophet.
You were in the shot as well.
They called him Wakia.
Why is it?
And they said that 3 large sailing boats arrived in Tahiti. And Wakia, the white god in the white robe and the golden sandals, he disembarked from this sailing ship in a longboat canoe. This is the first story. And there are other stories in the book about him arriving, visiting different Indian tribes in the Americas.
The Native Americans.
Native Americans, yes. And the there are several Indian tribes who have the same story as the Book of Mormon about bearded men coming over on an ocean crossing with an older brother who and a younger brother who are at enmity, but they call them by different names. It's the same story, but different names.
Okay, so what's the point of this that you want to establish with this story? What is it you...
Right.
So are you saying that this is kind of... there's no basis for it? Is that what you're trying to say?
Well, it seems that, according to this book and the legend...
Policy number one.
...that there were many islands in the Indian Ocean who have legends of... they give him different names, but they're talking about the same person by the way they describe him.
So the description is quite vague. I mean, a man with a beard on a boat, you know, that could be like anyone in the medieval times.
Well, it seems quite logical to me because in the visit to Tahiti, there's no reference to his wounds, no reference at all to his wounds. So he quite easily could have traveled on a boat with his own corpse on a fleet of ships to the Indian Ocean before his ministry in Jerusalem. There was plenty of years where there was a big gap in Christian history where we don't know what he was doing.
Oh, you mean his younger days?
His younger days, yes. So he could have easily made a long trip to the Pacific Ocean and the Americas. And they could easily have, if, as the Muslims believe, and as I believe, they killed him not.
Oh, you don't believe?
No, I don't believe.
Seriously?
It. No? Absolutely, absolutely. I absolutely believe that he did not die through crucifixion.
He's still alive.
So, because I know there is a hadith in Islam, that the hadith that I'm referring to is the hadith that says Jesus will return in his physical body, live for about 40 years, and then he will die.
We believe in his second coming.
Yes.
So we believe he's going to live like a normal life, like have a wife, have children.
Well, I believe,
and then he's eventually going to die.
I believe this was an oral tradition at the time of Jesus
coming to
was passed on. Now this oral tradition could have only been fulfilled if he had returned in his own physical lifetime. Like, I believe he lived to at least 80 years of old. Some people say 120, but I believe personally that he probably lived to about 80 years of age. And he could have returned in that lifetime, but there was no foundation in Jerusalem for him to return. James, his brother, was killed in Jerusalem by the Romans, and of course Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans in AD 70. So there was no material foundation for him to return in some kind of glorious capacity in that day. So that oral tradition of what might happen, Jesus returning for 40 days, living for 40 years and then dying, could not be fulfilled regarding a return to Jerusalem because there was no foundation.
Just to clarify, the Muslims do not believe that Jesus had come, lived for 40 years, and has already died. We believe that he will come in the second coming.
Yes,
so this will be closer to the Day of Judgment.
Yes, I know you believe that. I know that's what the Sunni Muslims
and
believe.
One of his main objectives for the second coming is to kill the Antichrist. So that is one of his main objectives. When he
comes I have a different perspective on the second coming. Now, so I think this return that the apostles expected and St. Paul expected is quite different to the quite different to the what is now referred to by Christians as the second coming.
The early Christians kind of believed that he was going to return in their lifetime.
Now, Jesus, as a Christian, I believe Jesus was the Christ. He was the Messiah. He was who he said he was.
Do you believe that he was God?
No.
You don't. You're not a Jehovah's Witness.
I'm not a Jehovah's Witness.
Because many Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe that he's a God as well.
Right.
I think
what I believe is the messianic mission which Christ had was a worldwide mission. It wasn't just for the Israelites. It was a worldwide mission. All the worldwide religions prophesied about someone coming with a worldwide mission as the Messiah to bring the kingdom of God to the whole planet. So I believe somebody else has to come in this role as Christ. And for example, in the Bible, the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verse 12, it says, he will have a new name. So how can Jesus have a new name? Because, just like Jesus said, John the Baptist is the fulfillment of the second coming of Elijah. He is not John the Baptist was not Elijah. He was a different man, but he had the same mission as Elijah, to make straight the way of the Lord. So this is the context in which Jesus is talking about the second coming of Elijah. He says John the Baptist is the second coming of Elijah. He said this. It's in the Bible.
So who's the one who's going to come instead of Jesus?
It's not for me to...
I mean, you must have some idea. I'm not asking you to...
Okay. Okay, there are three personages who make a very serious claim to this title.
Run.
The first one that you are...
Sorry, which title is this?
The title of the promised Messiah. The second coming of Christ.
You lose.
The first one you are very familiar with, which is, of course, Ahmad of Kenya, who said he was the promised Messiah. And who...
who's this?
Ahmad of the Ahmadi...
Qadiani.
The founder of the Ahmadi Muslim. Ahmadi Muslim.
Mirza Ahmad Qadiani.
This gentleman, he made a serious claim that
he was the promised Messiah.
Yes, so... And then there is, in 1844, Baha'u'llah, founder of the Baha'i faith. He was very much persecuted by what are now the Iranians, the Persians, who find a resting place is in Israel, in the north of Israel, north of Haifa. I can remember the place. And the third, so he brought a whole new religion. Like the Baha'i faith is a whole new religion, it's not Islam.
It's not, no. It's kind of picking from different religions, made it into one.
Yeah, where everyone in the Baha'i faith can contribute through their local spiritual assemblies. People are elected onto the national bodies and
the
bodies.
And the third person who made a very serious claim is the Reverend Sun Myung Moon of Korea. He claims that he had a spiritual encounter with Jesus on Easter morning on a mountainside in North Korea. And he claims that Jesus asked him three times to fulfill the mission which he could not fulfill when he was physically alive on the earth. Eventually the Reverend Moon agreed he would do it. He would do that mission. So what essentially is the legacy of the Reverend Moon? He died at 93 years of age. The legacy is the international marriage interfaith blessing. He believes the world will be, the kingdom of God will come through God-centered marriages. So the slogan is one world under God. So in many places, there has been performed international blessed marriages where the leaders of the different religions pour the water from the jug into the big bowl to show the oneness of all of religions. Yes. And the other aspect is...
That wasn't the mission of Jesus, was it? The second coming?
Well...
What do you think was the mission of Jesus? That is if you believe in the second coming.
Well, basically, the members of Sunya, it was founded as the Holy and Spiritual Association for the Unification of World Christianity. He put together what is called the Divine Principle. Divine Principle, which is a teaching based on lots of biblical references. But one of the most recent, before he died, he left eight books for the membership to read. One of those books is World Spirit. I've got it on my email. There are over 1,000 pages where there are quotations also from the Quran on various aspects of theology. this is called World. This book is called World Scripture. This is one of the favorite books.
The
Bible and quotations elsewhere as well. But the other legacy, besides the idea of restoration through blessed marriages, is a constitution. In plain English, the constitution of the kingdom of God. In Korean, this is referred to, in Korean, it's called Chon Il Guk, Chon Il Guk. And I only know a few aspects. I haven't read the whole constitution, but I've read parts of it. One part, a very important part, is freedom of religion.
That's right.
Because God will not judge us upon what we believe. People believe all kinds of things, according to their understanding. We are judged upon what we do, how we lead our lives. So in the kingdom of God, we will have freedom of religion to believe whatever we want to believe. But we are only judged upon what we do, not what we believe.
So when you say what we do, so who decides what we do is right?
Well, in the kingdom of God, there are many laws. There will be many laws. People will be judged by those laws.
No, but the laws are given by God, and God will say that this is forbidden for you, this is permitted for you.
So
these are the laws of God. But if someone like this Reverend Moon says, God is going to judge you by your works, then is he going to go by a particular definition of what is good and what is bad based on the Bible, or is it something of his own?
I haven't even read this whole constitution. I'm only familiar with parts of it.
I think none of those three claim to be the promised Messiah, ever fulfilled what the objective of the Messiah was.
I would agree that the whole objective of the Messiah is, although he said, words to the effect that it is finished, I have fulfilled all conditions, etc. There are still things which have not been done on a physical material level.
Because did he not say that I have many things to tell you and you cannot grant them?
Yes.
Yes, and the paraclete will come and lead you to all truth.
Yes.
What do you think he meant by that? This is
in
John 14, I believe.
Yes, I
14 and 16 as well.
One thing I would say about after the Reverend Moon's death, when he was 93, his wife took over the official leadership. Yet, she has not followed the directives of her husband. So she has created a whole new theology that, frankly, is different from what the husband thought. So there is another competing theology.
Another religion.
So there is a schismatism. Just like in Islam, there is schismatism also in his foundation. And that is, before he died, he wanted an heir apparent to represent his teachings. And he invited the eldest son to attend him. The eldest son chose not to do that because he wanted to do what he was doing in South America. So eventually, three other sons had died. There were only three sons left. So eventually, he settled upon the youngest son to be his inheritor. And he performed a kingly coronation ceremony in Korea. I think in America, and twice in Korea, and this son, Youngjin, who is known as Sean, he gives every Sunday, like a Sunday service, out of Pennsylvania, in America, where he was born, and there's also what's something called the King's Report. So the theology of this son is the theology of kingship, that he is the second king, and his son will be the third king.
So yeah, going back to my question with regards to Jesus,
yes,
saying that he has many things to say, and then he mentions the paraclete, he's going to come and lead. lead to you all, lead you into all the truth, basically.
Well, I can only speculate upon what he meant.
Yeah. It doesn't matter. I just want to know your viewpoint.
I can only speculate, so I would prefer not to speculate.
Okay. But because it's mentioned in two different places, so John 14, John 16, so there must be some importance to it?
Yes.
Yeah. So, his mission was not fulfilled. That is the reason he's saying that there are many things to tell you now, but he cannot bear them.
Yes.
And he, the Paraclete, will come and lead you to the truth. As Muslims, we believe that this is referring to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Prophet of Islam, the last messenger of the Prophet of Islam, because he is the only one who recognized Jesus from the major faiths as the Messiah, as someone who is a prophet of God, one of the mightiest messengers of God as well. And this is something, he acknowledges Jesus as Christ, as a Messiah, and he also teaches, similar to Jesus, about the oneness of God, not the Trinity, which many Christians do believe. I'm assuming you don't believe in the Trinity.
No.
Because you don't accept Jesus as God.
No.
Okay. So this is what the message of Islam is. So it's kind of very similar to the message of the other prophets in the Old Testament. They also believe and advocate the oneness of God. You believe that if you believed in whoever the current prophet or messenger, so if you were in the time of Noah and you believed in Noah, then you would have eternal life. If you believed in one God and believed in the message of Noah and basically acted upon that. And the same goes with Abraham, with Moses, with Jacob, with, you know, all these different prophets, including Jesus and the last of the messenger of Moses. So if you believe the message of God, if you believe in the oneness of God, if you believe in His messengers, His books, and His revelations, and His angels, and this is basically in a practice called the six articles of faith. Obviously, there's the other belief in life and death, and belief in your destiny. Yes. So these are all things that is core and kind of similar in the religion.
Yeah, so for example, unlike the Jehovah's Witnesses who believe in the resurrection, the dead is something of a physical nature. I disagree with them profoundly regarding that. I agree that any references to the resurrection of the dead in the last days is a reference to spiritual resurrection. It's an upliftment of the spirit, the growth of the spirit.
We do the documentary.
So when you say resurrection of the spirit, will it take place like on earth or will it be somewhere else?
Well, I believe it could be take place on the earth and take place in the spirit world simultaneously with different people.